It looks to me like we've got a common need. I've got a need to love you moment by moment. You've got a need to be free from that baggage moment by moment. So when those things come up in you, the old feelings of depression or anxiety or worry or fear, those are flashing red lights that tell you what. They're warning signals that tell you what's happened just now. You've closed the door to His life. Now, if God leaves those things in you, in your mind, to remind you when you've closed the door, and to make sure that you stay near to Him, then are those things Satan's stronghold to destroy you, or God's stronghold to make sure you have abundant life? It's God's stronghold. So that one thing in my life that I've said, Lord, if you'll just take this one problem away, I'll be able to serve you completely. If you'll just get rid of this one thing in my life, I'll be right on track with you, is the only assurance God has you'll ever stay on track with Him. Now, this is the rub in Christianity, because everybody wants a one-time fix. But God hates a one-time fix. Because if I have a one-time fix, I'm never going to have anything to do with God again. If I get a one-time fix, I won't have anything to do with Him. I don't want to mess with Him anymore. So He keeps me in constant dependence. Remember in the Old Testament when Israel had to go out every morning and get the manna? Collect it off the ground, you remember that? They'd eat it. If they tried to collect enough for 2 days, what happened to it the second day? It was all worms. Jesus says in John 6 that He's the true manna that comes out of heaven. The Jesus you had yesterday is worms today. You've got to gather Him again. He needs to be gathered moment by moment. The prayer time you had this morning will not take you through the day. He wants fellowship moment by moment. If you cut a branch off within an hour, it's withering. If you're out of fellowship with the Lord for an hour, you're withering. I would like to know in Scripture, and I know in the Old Testament there's some of that, but where we come up with this idea of quiet time. Yes, it's true that Jesus did go apart. It doesn't say He went apart every morning. Instead, the emphasis Jesus had was that He lived in an unending fellowship with the Lord. Now, here's why I really get encouraged. The person with the most problems has the most potential for God. The person with the worst residue will be used the most with the Lord, because he's got more flashing red lights telling him to abide, to warn him when the door's closed. The person in the worst set of circumstance will experience the deepest walk in the Lord, because they've got to turn over to Him. But the person who's well-adjusted and has great talent, ability, and intellect is rarely ever used of the Lord in a spiritual work. They use themselves frequently in a fleshly work that doesn't produce any fruit, but not in a spiritual work. And do you see now where Paul said to God, why don't you get rid of this thorn in my flesh? I'd like to get rid of that thing, because if it wasn't there any longer, I could serve you. And the Lord says, wait a minute, that's the only assurance I got. You will serve me. Because as long as that's there, you got to turn to me. And Paul says, now I get it. You mean then that power is going to be perfected in my weakness. That as those things come up in me and I say I can't, the door swings open and your life comes through me and it's manifested and power is perfected in weakness. Paul says, that's pretty neat. I think I'm going to start boasting in my weakness instead of being ashamed of it. Because it's the very thing that God's going to use. So the weakest person will be used most by the Lord. That's pretty nice, isn't it? And you know, there's such a thing in the Bible, I call it God talk, but God talk and man talk are two different things. Christianity will almost always be 180 degrees from what you think it is. And who would have thought that God would use the weak things in the world to shame the strong, the foolish things to shame the wise? And it is an incredibly simple life. But I want you to see, he doesn't take that stuff away. That's his stronghold. Do you see now where I could say to the homosexual, if you're really blessed of God, the only time your desire in the area of homosexuality will go away is when you're abiding with Christ? If you're really blessed of the Lord. So that's his stronghold. And that God wants us moment by moment to abide. Let's take a little break and we'll come back and talk about abiding a little bit. John 15 to you. As we look at this topic of abiding. I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that it may bear more fruit. You're already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up. And they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Now I think that we can learn a lot about what is most important in Christianity by the things that Satan keeps us from the most. Would that make sense? The things that he tries to keep from me are probably the things that are most important. And if you've noticed often when we have prayer meetings, that we could spend a lot more time in prayer, but it just seems like everybody's got to do something else before they ever get to prayer. And we know that God rules the world by the prayers of his saints. That's how he moves the world. Yet, I've never been to a Bible college or seminary, and I don't know of one that has a course in prayer. Well, we know that's the only way things get done. Satan moves us away from the things that offer us the most power. And I believe one of the things that he moves us away from most frequently is abiding with Jesus moment by moment. That daily abiding in him. Now he says something in John 15 that's just incredible to me when he says, I am the true vine. He doesn't say that anywhere else. He uses analogies from nature and he says the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. But when he says that he's the true vine, what he's telling you is that every vine exists to preach and teach him. That if it weren't for him, there would be no vines. That God created the vine to teach Jesus. So you want to know everything there is to know about the Christian life. All you need to do is go sit in a vineyard and you'll learn it. And that's all you have to know about it because every vine is created to preach and to reveal him to us. And one of the things we see in a vine is that there is absolute dependence and confidence in the gardener or the vine dresser to take care of everything. And we see that in Jesus' life. And he says that my Father is the vine dresser. Then my Father's going to take care of all the circumstances, all the watering, all the digging, everything that needs to be done to make me have a great life. Well, believe it today that God is taking care of every circumstance that we might have, every problem that we might have, that there isn't a thing that comes into our life that doesn't pass through his hands first. And he's taking care of all of it, and we can have all the confidence that we need to have. Now, one of the things that he points out to us here is that the vine actually needs branches. Because without branches, there's no way for the vine to manifest its life in fruit. So the thing that we need to recognize is that God actually needs us. Jesus needs you to be a branch. But he doesn't want you to be anything else than a branch or anything more than a branch. Again, we're going back to these standards where we have standards for ourselves that's higher than God. But he doesn't want that. He wants you to be content to be a branch. And all a branch is to do is to receive his life. Now, here's John 15:2. Let me read it to you. Every branch in me that bears no work, that doesn't lead people to Christ, that's not a success, that doesn't have a ministry, that doesn't have a divine marriage, that doesn't memorize Scripture, he takes away. Is that what it says? What's he say? Every branch in me that doesn't what? Bear fruit. Now, we need to know what our purpose in life is, and our purpose in life is to bear fruit. And the fruit's not for me, it's for others. It's for others to eat and enjoy. Specifically, it's for God to have and to enjoy. One of the things that we do, as soon as we make our own salvation, our own comfort, our own temporal life, our own family, our priority in life, our purpose for existence, and we say to God, as soon as we get those things straightened out, we'll turn to you. The moment you say that, the answer to your life escapes you. It's the old thing of think of a pink elephant. I'd like everyone in this room to think of a pink elephant. And the first one to forget it, raise your hand. You can't forget it because you're thinking about it. It's consuming all your energy. And as long as your comfort, your welfare, your family, your temporal values, all that kind of thing is at forefront, you'll never have your eyes on Jesus because he's behind all those. And he's the answer to those. And all that a branch is commanded to do is to abide. To abide in him. Now, I really like this concept of abiding, and I've just done some study on the vine. Have any of you ever done any grafting? That kind of thing. If you could look under it in a telescope, what happens is that when you put a branch in a vine, that branch is dead. You know, there's no life in that branch. So you put it into the vine, and the branch musters all that it has together and tries with a real feeble, feeble attempt to send out these little things that kind of look like roots or fibers into the vine. But there's no way. The beauty of grafting is that the vine dresser holds the branch in place and the vine reaches out with a force 1,000 times greater and pulls it in and holds it there. The branch with a force of one tries to get a hold. The vine gets a hold of it with a force of 1,000. Your feeble attempts to abide in Christ are rewarded with a force 1,000 times greater than you that pulls you in and holds you there. That all you have to do with the words of your mouth is say, Lord, I choose to abide moment by moment. And God is the one that will hold you there, and Jesus will reward that feeble attempt with a force 1,000 times greater to suck you in. Isn't that nice? And all you've got to do is focus in on him. Just make, see, the gospel and the Christian life and the victorious life and the abundant life is for the weakest person. If it's so simple to live defeat, it's got to be simple to live victory. And it's just that simple. With the words of my mouth, today, Lord, in the morning, I choose to abide. And that's rewarded with a God that holds me in and a Jesus that pulls me close with a power much greater than mine. And as I rest, his life flows through me and I produce fruit without work. Now, machines produce work. And they do a lot of work. But only life can produce fruit. My mother has had for a long time, and she must change them every once in a while, but I remember as a kid, and I remember them recently, she has plastic fruit on her table. And that is good-looking stuff. And it really does look good. And I remember even in college, and even after I was married, coming back and grabbing one of those bananas or those grapes or whatever, and they've even got them where they look kind of frosty and like you want to eat them. They look real pretty, but there's nothing to them. And if you could go to the factory that produces the fruit, it's loud, it's noisy, and it stinks. but it's producing something real pretty. When a Christian is working to produce fruit, he's loud and he's noisy and he stinks. And the more fruit he's trying to produce, the more work he's trying to do, the more noise he's creating. And yet there's nothing there when you're done. You know what the beauty to me of a vineyard is that you go down there and get your sleeping bag and lay it down between those rows, and the fragrances are really nice, and there's no sound, and the grapes grow without effort. And all of a sudden, there they are, and you can pick them, and not only are they beautiful, but there's something there you can eat. Work, or a machine produces work, but life produces fruit. And as we abide and we allow the life to flow through us that is already totally victorious, that's already overcome every problem that we'll ever have, it's a life without effort. It's not imitating, it's participating. And I believe that Jesus, in John 15, was confronting a coming heresy. He knew that there was going to be one heresy that would exist. And that heresy would be that you could imitate his life. That you could live the life that he lives. And again, that's what Andrew Murray said. The worst heresy in the church is a continual emphasis on what we can do for God and not what God has done for us. Or better yet, what we do and not what God does in us. And so he confronts that heresy by saying, apart from me, you can't do anything. You close that door to Christ's life and you're not going to get a single thing done. Laws produce work, and work is effort and labor. But life is natural and it's silent. And it just comes out of me, and it's a beautiful thing as it comes through. Now, one of the things, and we'll press on, that I think is interesting is that every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it that it'll bear more fruit. I've always heard that taught that the pruning we go through is when God takes sin out of our life and he's pruning me and I'm miserable because God's pruning me and he's taking away the things that he doesn't like. But I really see in this, now that I've studied it, that what the vine dresser prunes are the shoots that bore the fruit last year. It's the good things that they cut away. He takes the long shoots that bore fruit last year and cuts them away. And the reason he does that is that if you don't cut it away, this year it'll want more sap and give less fruit. And with each increasing year, it'll take more sap and produce less fruit. Now, how many ministries do you know like that? That they did something that 20 years ago worked, and it worked so well, they refused to get it pruned away. And so each year they put more effort into it. And on the 20th year, it takes 20 times the effort, and it produces 20 times less fruit. And the same thing can be true in our own talents and abilities, that we've used those in the past, and God used them to bear fruit, but we won't let him cut them away and do something new. And the reason he wants to cut away the things that bore fruit last year is that we all run the risk of beginning to trust those things instead of trusting him. That makes sense? Those things are working so well for us that we don't want to let go of them. And so we begin to stagnate. And we need to allow God to keep taking us through that pruning so his life will produce more and more. And it's a real call to abiding. Now, as we abide, that life comes through us. His life is natural. We live a victorious life because his life is victorious. What are the hindrances to abiding? Why do people shut that door? Why do you suppose we shut that? I've been thinking about that, and I listed a few things, and you could come up with some. But I think we shut it because of unbelief. We don't believe God's going to really take care of it. That we've got to handle it. And that God doesn't go according to our time schedule. And of course, the key word in the Old Testament is wait, because wait equals faith. But we don't want to wait to see it happen. I think there's a fear of abandonment to God, to just letting our whole life go into His hands and whatever He does is fine. There's a real fear to that. Because I still like to make my own decisions. There's certain things that I want to do that I really don't want to pray about and ask God what He wants. And there's certain people that I want to punish and I don't want Him getting in the way and making me loving them. I want to make them get their due. So there's that fear of abandonment and loss of control. One thing may be that we don't know that we need to do that, that we need to open the door. It may be ignorance. It can be the cares of the world or the loves of the world or the worries of the world that we don't want to open it up. It can be that I've got more faith in the wisdom of men than I do in the power of God. I want others to help me. Can't trust Him. And I think maybe a key thing is that we see abiding as an effort. And all of our efforts to do anything else have all failed. You know, all the efforts to change in the past haven't worked and they failed. And I've given up on them. And now I'm talking about abiding as something I need to do every day. And if I see that as an effort that I do, and I see me as the one who's responsible to get a hold of Him, to hold myself in place, and to generate life, then I don't want to abide. And I'm afraid that's how most people see it. That if you're a Christian, do this. Instead of, if you're a Christian, abide in Him and let His life come through you. And He'll do what He wants. So those are kind of hindrances that we might have as we look to the abiding life. Now again, God wants me moment by moment. I want to now take a closer look at that old Adam life in you. Because what I'm looking at are the flashing red lights that tell you when you're not abiding. And you can kind of think of it as an airplane. You know, when you fly an airplane, you got all kinds of gauges on there. And the one of them that I like to look at all the time is the altimeter, because I want to know if I'm losing altitude. And that's a real significant one, because you might buy the farm. Well, this residue in my mind is like an altimeter. If all that stuff's coming up and I'm feeling all those old things again, I'm losing altitude. And the more of those things I can pinpoint, the more readily I can apply power and open the door and let Christ's life come through me and gain altitude. If we're commanded to take up the cross and deny ourselves, how do we deny ourselves if we don't know what ourself is? So what I'm doing is trying to let you get a handle on what your self-life is. So we know part of your self-life is that old identity that you had, that's residue up in your mind, the fear, or the failure, the worthless person, all that kind of thing, the rejected, unacceptable. That's part of the residue. But there's also some residue in your mind that has to do with unbelief. And I want to kind of look at more of that residue and see if we can't pinpoint it and tell what it is. So we want to take a closer look at that Adam life in you. And another way that it was developed. So far, we've only looked at it as being developed through identity messages. Here's a picture of the temple, and you got three boxes here. The two boxes in the middle, one is the Holy of Holies. That's where God dwelt. The next is the holy place, and then the outer court. And I believe that God's temple on earth was to teach spiritual truths about God in heaven. That there was something to be learned from that temple, that it was symbolic of what was going on in heaven. That temple had three parts, and just as that temple had three parts, we have three parts, a spirit, a soul, and a body. The spirit would be like the Holy of Holies where God dwells, the soul, the holy place where work is done, and then the outer courts, the body. In the Old Testament, you could have forgiveness of sins. There could be a sacrifice out here. And that sacrifice would allow you to come this far, but no farther. You could come all the way to the veil that separated the Holy of Holies and the holy place, but you could never go through the veil. And I believe that the veil represented that Adam life that's in me, the old man. And what God was saying to you was this: you can come near because I love you when you're forgiven. But you can't come all the way in or any closer because you've got a life in you that hates me. And that life's got to go. You've got a life in me that's, or in you that's pitted against me. So come near because I love you, but stay away because of what you are. Come near forgiven, but stay away because of the life that's in you. And the veil represented God's infinite nearness in that He's just on the other side of it, but His infinite distance in that you could never get there. And that's why Nicodemus is told, you've got to be born again. Now remember earlier I said I was crucified with Christ, Galatians 2:20, that old life was killed with Him. Do you remember what happened to the veil the day Jesus was crucified? It was rent in two. Because that Adam life was killed in Christ. And the glory that was hid in the holy place flooded out into the whole being. Now I believe that every Christian has Christ in their spirit. They've got God in the Holy of Holies. They are the temple of God. And that was the thing, of course, that got the Jews upset with Jesus, because He said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I'll rebuild it. Remember that? And they wanted to kill Him. The reason they were mad at Him is the word He used for temple was naos, the Greek word, which is the Holy of Holies. He didn't say tear down the bricks, but He said go into the very presence of God and destroy that place where God dwells, and I'll rebuild it. And that made them mad because nobody would go in there, the high priest, once a year. But what Jesus was saying to them was, I am the very presence of God. I am God's dwelling place. I'm the Holy of Holies, and you tear me down and I'll be rebuilt. And then in 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 6:19, He says, you are the temple of God. And the word that He uses there is, guess what? Naos. The Holy of Holies, His dwelling place. So Christians have Christ dwelling in them, in their Holy of Holies. They are the Holy of Holies. But because of a veil of unbelief, His life is never released. And when an event takes place, they try to handle it with their body or with their mind, their will, their emotions. And their response comes from those areas. I was taught in Bible college and graduate school that success as a minister rested in these two areas, soul and body. It depended on how much you knew, how strong of a will you had and how you could act, how emotional you were and how you could move emotions, and how good you looked. And so what they did is they prepared me to minister in the flesh to other people's flesh. And that's one of the problems with churches. They bring in a fellow who ministers to everyone's flesh. He feeds their mind. He feeds their will. He feeds their emotions. He's a happy-go-lucky guy, and he gets them to build a huge church. But he's not feeding their spirit. The guy still can't get along with his wife. He's still a drug addict. He's still sneaking around getting a drink. He's still a slave to pornography. She's still slandering. She's still nagging her husband. Her spirit's not being ministered to. And so pretty soon the people go out the back door as fast as they go in the front, and they go look for someone else that can minister to their flesh. So all you can do if you're built up in that area is speak to another person in that area. But if the veil is rent, then we can minister to people spirit to spirit. And that's how we want to live our lives. We want the Spirit coming through us. But this veil will often prevent any of that from taking place or happening. Now I want to look at that veil of unbelief and see what makes it up. And kind of look at the warp and the woof of that veil. What makes up that veil are the threads, and I got a little box here drawn like a veil. And on one side are my hurts. That's the threads going horizontally. And what makes up the vertical threads is the way I've coped with those hurts. For every hurt that you've had in your life, you had to learn how to cope. And the proof that every one of us knows how to cope is that we're here this morning. Because if you don't know how to cope, what do you suppose you do? Yeah, you kill yourself. You can't take it any longer. Because you can't find a way to get you through the day. Now, every one of us had to learn how to cope without Christ. Let me give you an example of a minister. And this fellow is working real hard, and he's got a lot of work to do, and he's real busy. And his wife feels sorry for him because he works till midnight every night. So she decides to go up to his office and surprise him with some sandwiches at midnight, and she's the only one with the key to his office. So she pops into his office, surprised with a bag of sandwiches, a Coca-Cola, and opens the door, and guess who gets the surprise? She does. He's got pornography all over the room, and he's on the phone making an obscene phone call. So she walks into the room, and she's ready to lay hands on him, and it's not to pray. She's pretty upset with him. So she drags him down to me, and I find out that this fella has got a real hurt in his life. And that hurt was that at age 12, his father had become an alcoholic. And Saturdays were a living hell because this boy would come, or this father would get up in the morning, start drinking, and by noon be fighting with his mother. And he'd even seen his father take his mother by the back of the hair and put her face through a wall. Now, when you're 12 years old, that's quite a hurt that mom and dad fight, right? So for every hurt that you have to learn how to cope. You got to learn to get by with that hurt. So what he did is, he ran, and the first thing he did was to hide underneath his bed. But guess what he found when he crawled underneath his dad's bed to hide? Playboy magazine. And he found that as long as he was looking at Miss October, he wasn't even listening to the fighting that was going on out there. Well, now, if I have my choice between watching a mom and dad fight or look at Miss October, I'd rather look at Miss October, too. And all he looked forward to then was Miss October, Miss November, Miss December, Miss January, and it kept his mind off the turmoil and the stress and the fighting that was going on in his home. And pornography became for him not a coping mechanism, that's a worldly term, but it became an idol. It was actual idolatry. And what an idol is anything that I run to under stress and pressure if it's not Christ. That's an idol. Now, at age 16, this fellow became a Christian. He quit looking at pornography. He went to Bible college, seminary. Now, at age 42, his children are rebelling. His wife wants to leave him, and the church said they were going to fire him. If you were Satan, what would you tempt him with? Yeah, why? Why would you tempt him in pornography? Yeah, because it works. He's not going to tempt you in anything that doesn't work. And we've all found things in our life that work and help us get by through stress and pressure other than Christ. And so the enemy stands behind him and whispers, look at pornography. It worked before. See, the door's shut. The residue in the baggage is still there. And that's what he's working on. And he gets him to open that bag, and he opens up, and he goes and buys a Playboy magazine, he opens it up, but you know what? God won't allow a Christian to be an idolater. So he looks at it, and it doesn't help him. So you know what he does next? Does the enemy say, well, give up on that? No, he says, buy more pornography. Buy harder pornography. Get the hardcore stuff. It'll meet your need. And he keeps buying harder and harder pornography, but it won't meet his need because God won't allow it. And now he's totally frustrated, and all of a sudden he's full of worry and doubt and fear and anxiety and frustration and depression because his little idol won't help him anymore. It won't get him by. Now there's a story that I like of in Genesis 31. And you all know this story, but where Jacob works 7 years to marry Rachel. And remember who he woke up with? So he worked another 7 years and he got Rachel. Now he's got Rachel and Leah. And he works another 6 years and God takes all the wealth that belongs to Laban and gives it to him. Culturally, those girls had to serve the God of their husband. That was the rule, the law. They had to serve Jehovah. But would it be that hard to serve Jehovah when he'd done nothing but bless your family? I mean, he'd given Jacob everything. And yet, when those girls got ready to leave, what's the one thing they took with them? They went back and they got the saddlebag and they put idols in it. And they stole the household idols. Why'd they want them? Just in case Jehovah doesn't help me, we've got our idols. I'm not giving everything up to Jehovah. He may not completely help me. And I believe that every Christian enters into Christianity with a little saddlebag full of idols. Just in case God doesn't help me, I've got my idols that I can run to. And that idol, when I open it up, may be eating, may be food, may be withdrawal, may be sex, may be pornography, may be getting drunk, but I got one in there that'll handle this situation. Now, in Ezekiel 8, Ezekiel is told, dig in the side of the temple and tell me what you see. And Ezekiel says to God, all right, I'll dig in a vision. And he digs in the side of the temple and he sticks his head in the Holy of Holies and looks around and God says, what do you see? And Ezekiel pulls his head down and he says, you're not going to believe it. And God said, what do you see? And he said, the elders of Israel have hidden their idols in there. What are they doing in God's place? In God's house, what are those idols doing there? And see, I'm afraid for many of us, if you dig in to the Holy of Holies in us, you might find that we've hid a few idols in there. And that they're told in Ezekiel 20, verse 8, that Israel did not enter into the Promised Land because they refused to forsake their idols. Now, those idols can be ugly. Porno is an ugly idol. And I think probably drugs would be considered an ugly idol. Alcohol is an ugly idol. Those are unacceptable idols when we see them. But all they are is something that a person learned to run to that'll get them through the day. When it comes to the issue of hurt, there's two elements to hurt. Pain and rejection. Now, if I get drunk, it'll get rid of my pain, but it won't help my rejection. In fact, it may increase my rejection. If I do cocaine, it may get rid of my pain, but it won't help my rejection. If I work hard at the church, it may get rid of my rejection because people think I'm wonderful, but it won't do anything for my pain. If I make a tremendous financial decision that everybody lauds as being really great, that'll get rid of my rejection, but it won't get rid of my pain. Guess what the one thing is that gets rid of pain and rejection? And it's one of the most popular idols today because it's so readily available. It's this idol called sex. When people are involved in sex, they have pleasure, not pain, and they got somebody holding them. When you see 13 and 14 and 15-year-old girls involved in sex, I'll promise you those girls have a lot of hurt in their home. That they are full of hurt. And that's one of the problems we have today. Again, we refuse to look at the root rot. But when you see the hurt that's going on in home, the problem is not sex education. The problem is that that is something that's readily available that'll get rid of my pain and my rejection and will help me cope and get through the day. And it's just a very, very pleasing idol today. Now, it may cause more hurt because the person rejects me and doesn't want anything to do with me, and more pain, and I may get caught up in a cycle of pain and hurt. But it's one of the key idols that people have today. But there's also idols that don't look too bad, that are kind of semi-acceptable idols, like clothes, or I'll go shop when I get depressed, or I'll go eat, or I'll go watch the TV, or I'll go read, or maybe I withdraw, or maybe I become quiet, or maybe I yell. Then there's some grade A idols, and these are the ones that are just wonderful. These are really good ones. I'll be a PhD. It was like the fellow who had gone through a medical school, and that I was counseling, and he couldn't make it the last year, and he's ready to commit suicide. And I said, why are you going to commit suicide over not being a doctor? And he said, oh, I always really wanted to help people. And I said, I don't believe that you always wanted to help people. I believe, knowing you, that you couldn't wait to go home and be introduced to your dad as doctor. And it wasn't to help other people, it was to help you. It was to milk your identity out of them, to get your need met, to be called doctor. You wanted to go to the basketball game and be called out as doctor. And he said, that's exactly right. Now, I'm not saying again that these things are always idols, but if I run to them and I don't run to Christ, they are an idol. Here's a grade A idol that's really a dandy. Ministry. My wife tells me I'm doing a terrible job as a husband. I'll go preach and let 300 people tell me I'm wonderful. Now, I'll have to be honest, 300 people have never told me I was wonderful. But that's the kind of thing you can see in ministry. They're not out there buttonholing and witnessing to people for the person. They're doing it for themselves. They're not in authority and in control and in charge and working all this around to really see someone come up into Christ. They're doing it all for themselves. They want to be somebody. They want the free lunch you get with being called pastor or minister. There's some other idols that are really popular today, like homosexuality. That's all that is. And a real interesting idol, and I'll throw this out and you can throw it out then after I do. But I think there's an idol today called insanity. That when I'm under stress and pressure, I just go crazy and everyone leaves me alone. Now, I was with a fellow on the East Coast, and this happened to me more than once. But in this particular case, it was a little wild. But I got in to see him, and he was just babbling and going on and on. Didn't make any sense, wouldn't talk to me, just mad. And I put my arm around him, and I said, look, you're like a man who, when he's under pressure, he ties a rope around a tree. And then he heads off into a cave. And he hides in there till the pressure's over. And the name over your cave is insanity. But I said, the thing I know about you is that you haven't let go of the rope yet. Now, there are some people that go back in that cave and let go of the rope. And they're pretty hard to find. But I asked him to get a hold of the rope and come out. Well, the next day I got to see him, and they put us in a special observation room for doctors, and got in there, and it was just me and him. And I've had people pull this on me before, but anyway, he says, I'm going to jump out the window. Well, I really don't think you can jump out those windows, even though it doesn't have bars. It's thick plexiglass stuff. But I said, go ahead and jump. Let me just move this coffee table out of the way so you can get a good run. And so I stood back, and he ran as fast as he could towards this window, and then he tried to stop before he hit it, and he hit it and splat, fell down flat, and got on his hands and knees. And he looked up at me and he said, that was crazy, wasn't it? And I said, yeah, that was crazy, but the very fact that you know it's crazy tells me you're not. And I said, I've noticed you in here. You have a lot of fun. People send you presents. People feel sorry for you. Every time one of the nurses walk by, I notice that you reach up and grab them, and the nurses, all they do is just move your hands because you're crazy. And I said, you know, after watching you for a few days, I'm considering going crazy myself. I thought, that doesn't sound too bad at all. And we began to share, and he began to slowly come out of that. But this poor guy had had all kinds of abuse. He had all kinds of things happen to him. And he'd learned to cope through that kind of thing. And the interesting thing was, is that there are members of his family that had all learned to cope that way all the way through. I had a guy show up at Christmas. I don't know if you remember this fella. But he's having suicidal thoughts at Christmas. And he says, gee, I don't know why I'd have suicidal thoughts like this. And I got his history. And his father had come in on Christmas when he was 11 and killed himself. And his grandfather had killed himself on Christmas. And he's wondering why he might be having thoughts at Christmas time about suicide. But again, suicide, even that can become an idol. It's my little precious. It's my little thing that I look to that's going to redeem me, that's going to get me out of the world. It's the thing that when the pressure's on too much, I run to my little idol suicide and I cuddle it and I talk to it. And I tell it someday it's going to get me out of this world and won't everyone else be sorry that it does, that this has happened to me. And I love that little thing called suicide. You can have the idol of control. I'm going to control everything. Now, I was talking to a fella who was a homosexual, and he came in, and my first clue I was in trouble is that he said, you're my last hope. Whenever anybody tells you you're their last hope, don't spend much time with them because they have no intentions of getting well. And in that little phrase, what they're telling you is that their success rests on your shoulders, not on theirs. That if they get well, it's because you did it. And if they don't, it's your fault, not theirs. And they usually fully intend to leave without getting any help. But we got along, and this guy said, oh, I've tried everything to get over this homosexuality. Well, I don't want to, I just can't do it. I just can't. I'm so miserable. I just can't get rid of it. And I asked him, I said, if I could give you a pill, and you would take that, and it would wipe homosexuality off the face of the earth, it wouldn't even be possible, it wouldn't be here, and all the desire in you would be gone, would you take the pill? What do you think he said? Yeah, he'd take the pill. And I said, well, wait a minute, let me ask you this. Let me ask you a question. What do you do right now when you're depressed? Oh, I fantasize. What do you do when you had a rough day at work? I go to the gay bar after work. What do you do when you've had a fight with your wife? I go to the gay park. Well, if you take this pill, what are you going to do from now on when you're depressed, when things don't go well at work, when you have a fight with your wife? He said, I don't know. And I said, do you really want to take the pill? And he says, uh-uh. Now, all I was trying to do was show him where he was at. It's like when I was in India and they were telling me how to get to some place and they had a map. And I said, brothers, this map doesn't do me any good because I don't know where I'm at. Somebody's got to make a dot here somewhere so I know where I'm at and where I can go. I just wanted this guy to see where he was at. But what are the idols that we have? What are the things we run to other than Christ? And are we really willing to let go of them? Lord, take this from me. Take it from me. I can't stand it. Please take it from me. If you can get it out of my cold, dead hand, it's making me miserable. There's only four types of people in the world. There's the I, not Christ. That's every religion. There's the I and Christ. That's the guy that stays in control and he only wants Jesus for fire insurance so he doesn't have to go to hell, but he'll take care of everything else. Then there's the committed Christian who's always miserable, but they are really committed, who say Christ and I. I want Christ to take care of everything, and I want him to be in charge, and I'm going to serve him fully, but right here behind my back, I've got a little bag of idols, and if he doesn't do it right away and fix everything perfectly, I'll pull these out. And what we want to become is what Paul said he was, a Christ, not I, Christian. Now again, I believe that all of us have some of these idols, that many of us have those. And God puts us in a process of giving up on those idols. And we're going to look at now, how does that process work? How does he come to a point where I let go of those? What is the Lord allowing into my life that makes me shed those idols to allow him to do the work in me? And we'll do that right after lunch. Let's go ahead and look now at the process of coming to the end of myself, or more precisely, coming to the end of the idols that we've been talking about. Now, we just finished up lunch. I'll remind you what the old pastor told the group of people. I don't mind the babies crying at you, old people snoring that bother me. So you got to watch it after lunch here. You'll fade out. So we'll try to take some breaks and move along here. We've got a V drawn here. And at the top of the V, you notice I've got salvation there. At the bottom of the V, a cross. And then on the top on the other side, heavenly life. Now here's the process that I believe that we come into as a Christian. It's not until we're convicted of sin that we need a Savior, right? Not until the day that you have some kind of conviction within that you've got to have a Savior, or that you've sinned, that you need a Savior. Now, whose job is it to convict the world of sin? It's the Holy Spirit, right? That's what he says his job is. Now, when I realized this, one of the things I quit doing was witnessing to people. And I used to buttonhole everybody that I saw and share with them, and out of every 1,000 people I saw, maybe one came to Christ. And I quit doing that and let the Holy Spirit do his job. And now I never go out and witness at all, but the Lord's always bringing somebody to me. And he always brings them prepared by him, convicted by the Holy Spirit. And just as I was saying the other day when I was in the restaurant eating and the waitress unloads on me that she's in the middle of a divorce, and why is she telling me that? I'm just a guy that ordered a chicken club sandwich. Why am I hearing that? Well, I'm hearing it because the Lord brought her that way. And as I've rested in that, now, out of every 100 people I see, or 1,000 people I see, maybe one that something doesn't happen to. So I think the Lord's always working and always moving in that. But it's not until the conviction of sin that you need a Savior, and you can't do that job, and the people we want to come to Christ, we can't convince them of that or convict them, as much as we'd like to try. Once you see sin, you need a Savior. And that's when we accept Christ. Now Matthew 11:28 says, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you what?
Rest.
So he says that if you'll come to him, you'll get rest. That's verse 28. Verse 29 says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am lowly and gentle of heart, and you shall what? Find rest for your soul." In those two verses, Jesus talks about two rests. One is a rest that is given, and the other is a rest that has to be found. When you first come to Christ, he gives you rest. But there's a second rest that must be found, and that's by taking his yoke upon you and doing things the way he does it. Now, I've always heard that taught as a double yoke. I don't believe that is a double yoke where he pulls with you. It's taking his yoke. It's working and living and acting the same way he did, which was in total dependence, in total faith, without living in all these idols. That's how he lived his life. Now, God has to somehow bring you to the point where you'll stop trusting your idols. If we draw a little circle over here, and this represents Egypt. And Israel wanted to come out of Egypt and get into the promised land, and that'll be this other circle. How did they get out of Egypt? By looking to God or looking to themselves? Who brought them out of Egypt? Yeah, God brought them out. They did not have the strength or the power to get out, or they would have already left, right? I'm told that you can walk from Egypt to the promised land in 8 days, and it took them 40 years. Why? Because when they got out of Egypt and it came time to enter into the promised land, instead of looking up to God, they looked to themselves and said, "How will we get ourselves in there?" And Ezekiel, we've already looked at, told them that you wouldn't lay aside your idols. You were trusting your idols to get you into the promised land, to give you victory. You're trusting in your own effort. So they wandered for 40 years until they gave up on those idols and they said those two precious words again that the Lord loves to hear, "I can't." And God said, "Okay, come on in." So what happens with a Christian is that we come to Christ, we're holding our bag of idols, and we set out to serve Him. And we set out to free ourselves from our own sins through our own effort. Now again, if we could do that, Jesus wouldn't have had to come. So what God does is He structures things and He puts us in circumstances and situations that make me pull my idol out to try to cope with it, but it doesn't work. And He continues to drive me down to the cross. He wants me to give up on those idols. And now some of us are real tough, and He drives us down, and we pull out an idol that helps us. It turns things around. We get things straightened out, and we head back up. But God is greater than us, and He puts us in another situation that drives us down even farther. Jack Taylor says it like this, that God fixes a fix to fix you. And if you fix the fix that God fixed to fix you, He'll fix another fix to fix you, and brother, you'll be fixed. Now, if you go through that, it makes a lot of sense. He'll put you in a situation, a fix, to fix you, to make you run to your idol. If you fix that with your idol, He'll put you in another fix that you can't fix with that idol, and you'll be fixed, and you'll start throwing those things aside. Now, just as it was the conviction of sin that made Christ as your Savior make sense, it's the conviction of weakness that will make Christ as my strength make sense. And it's not until I'm totally persuaded of my weakness that Christ's strength will ever make any sense to me at all. I was going to Australia a couple of years ago, and I was asking the Lord, what is it You would have me share with the brothers there? And there was one thing that the Lord just kept impressing on me. You tell them, I'm the Creator and they're the creature. I'm the potter and they're the clay. You just tell them they can't, I can. Now there's only four words in the whole Bible that you have to memorize, and if you have those four words memorized, you don't have to know anything else. That's how simple it is. It's the first four words in Genesis. In the beginning, God. That's all you got to know. If you'll dwell on that, if you'll meditate on that, if you'll let those four words lead you, that's all you'll ever have to know. Just four words. God is everything. Our eyes are to be on Him. He's strong and I'm weak. He's wise and I'm ignorant. And I lean on Him in total dependence. And once I come to that point of complete weakness, on the other side of the cross is the heavenly life. There's power. There's gifts. But you can't get there from here to here. You got to go through the cross. You got to come to the end of yourself. You have to enter into faith in God and not keep trusting those kind of idols. Now, I think the question that come up then, how do I get rid of my idols? There's no question that the Lord wants to drive you to the point that you get rid of them. I got a tape from a friend of mine in Australia who is talking to his congregation. And he says, he begins the tape, and he's got a rather large congregation, and the people really love him there. And I really love him. He's just a neat brother. And he starts out the sermon by saying, confession is good for the soul, and I'm going to confess today that I've been drinking. Well, you could just hear the silence in the congregation when he said that. And he went on to tell him how things had gotten worse in his life, and he'd been driven to drink, and he was being driven to drink through this circumstance and that circumstance. And he said, finally, I've got to tell you, I've had so much pressure, I've been driven so much that I finally began to drink. And there's a long pause, and you just hear the gasp. And he says, well, I think some of you misunderstood me. I've been drinking alcohol. I've been drinking from the river of life. And then he asks the question, have you been driven to drink yet? Have your circumstances and your situations made you give up on you and your ability, and made you stop being the Creator and look to God to be the one who handles everything? No, that's a pretty good point. Now, once we're driven to drink, we need to get rid of these idols. How do we get rid of our idols? Well, the first thing we need to understand is that we shouldn't have them. I always get a kick out of that story in the Gospels where Jesus cast the demons into the pigs that the Jews had and they all got mad at him. Well, my question was, what were the Jews doing with those pigs anyway? They weren't supposed to have them to begin with. Yet they're mad when they're taken away. And the first thing we understand about idols is we weren't ever supposed to have them to start with. But now we've got them. And giving something to God is really very, very simple. It happens with the words in your mouth. And the beginning point again is to say that I don't deserve to have any of those.